What's up, everybody? Welcome to Floyd Street's Finest, here, Field of 68 Podcast Network. I'm Jack Grossman, and yes, the time has finally come. It's about, say, about 1:30 in the morning. Not gonna lie, I just got home from my quote-unquote day job, but you know what? I wanted to make sure I got something out here about Louisville making the move to get rid of parting ways with Kenny Payne that came out earlier on Tuesday night. So yeah, we're gonna get through a little bit of that here, just some instant reactions and just saying, yo, they're moving on, it's time, it's over. Mercifully, it's over for Louisville, ending at 12-52 record after losing to NC State in the first round of the ACC tournament earlier on Tuesday. And yes, we're going to get to a few different things here on this podcast, but just first of all, look, Josh Hurd, for better or for worse, gave Kenny Payne the full 2 years. And we saw throughout those 2 years that he is not the man for this job with Louisville. I mean, you went 12-52, you had more losses to Division II opponents than you had Roadwoods. My guy Kevin Sweeney had that stat today, which is just mind-blowing. You won one game away from the KFC Yum Center during your time as the head coach. That was the one at Miami earlier this year. And at the end of the day, it just wasn't good. It was really, really horrific. I'm not breaking any news here saying that. It was just bad basketball. Even a game like Tuesday, where you're shooting over 60% from the field in the first half, you end up shooting, I believe, 55% from the field. You're scoring in the 80s. You're up 14 at one point. Did anyone really think Louisville's going to win that game at any point in time? I didn't. I had a couple friends that jokingly said that, but like no one really bought into that. Because Louisville couldn't defend, even with DJ Horn and DJ Burns, Horn sick or her whatever it was, not playing, Burns in foul trouble the entire game, a bunch of scrubs for NC State, because that's pretty much what that team is. They aren't a tournament team. They're playing day one in the ACC. Scrubs is probably a little bit harsh, too harsh of a term, but NC State, without its two best players for the majority of that game, was able to work you on the defensive end and get whatever the heck they wanted pretty much at any point throughout that game. I think it was Brandon Huntley Hatfield had the quote after the game saying, look, we didn't have an identity defensively this year. And I'm like, no bleep. That was the whole issue with you. You couldn't defend as a team. I'm not pointing out Huntley Hatfield trying to single him out. He was a warrior all year here. One of the few bright spots. Scott Clark was another one on Tuesday, dropping 36. But Louisville had no plan of action of what they needed to do to get better. And there was nowhere that was seen clearly more on the court than on the defensive end of the court, because they had no idea what they were doing all year. We said this. I sat here on this podcast here, Floyd Street's Finest, Field of 68, like, subscribe, do all that stuff, Twitter, YouTube, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, wherever you're listening to this, give us a follow, give us a like, all that stuff. But I told you, back after the first Virginia game, when Louisville had 12 days between the Kentucky and the Virginia game, and a lot of people, including myself, wanted that move to be made before that, when you had that time, and they ended up not making that. I still think they should have made the move, but whatever. It's a moot point. It does not matter at this point. He got the full 2 years, and it was a catastrophe from start to finish. But in that Virginia game, they came out. They tried to play man-to-man. They tried the 2-3 zone, a 1-3-1, a 2-2-1 press, a full-court man press. At 5-6 different defenses, none of it worked. Shredded the entire time. It very much became clear that Kenny Payne was just throwing as much stuff against the wall as possible and saying, please, for the love of God, can something work? And that's not how you build a team. It's not how you build a culture. That's not how you build a basketball program. And that's just one aspect of one of the failures Kenny Payne had these last 2 years. And frankly, if he wasn't a former player and didn't have the good standing that he's had for so long within the university and the relationships he's had, he probably wouldn't have gotten that last half of the year. Now, for Kenny Payne, looking at the comments he made here in the postgame after NC State, it's rough. I mean, I was, for a guy, you know, again, I grew up a Louisville fan in the city. I went to Indiana, so I've seen coaches of the programs I follow more closely than anywhere else throw the fans under the bus a decent amount the last week or so. So, which is maybe that shouldn't be so surprising considering they were both assistant coaches with each other for the New York Knicks a few years back. But for Kenny Payne to go here and blame the fans for this is really not right. The fans, you had, you know, Matt Jones, like him or hate him, a lot of Louisville fans hate him, has been in the sports radio game around the city, around the state of Kentucky for a long time, Kentucky Sports Radio. For him to come out and say, you know, hey, I'm a dude that's defended Kenny for a lot of this, but you went 12-52 with he called it the seventh best job, whatever you want to call it, sixth, seventh, eighth, whatever. It's a top 10 job in the country. I'd probably say a top 8 job in the country. It's not the fans' fault that you're getting fired, man. This is on you. And for the quote is, it's unfortunate that we're talking about this right now. When I walked into the program as a new head coach, I needed everybody on the same page. We sort of forgot that. I went back and I looked at Kenny Payne's opening press conference. He goes on to say, after the NC State game, I talked about how I'm not going to let you blame me. I started standing up there by myself. I need all of Louisville with me. We sort of forgot that. Let's fact check that a little bit. Because I went and I read through the transcript of the opening press conference. And here's what he said back in March of 2022. I'm not up here by myself. My brothers are with me. This community has to be with me. The state has to be with me. With me isn't when it's good. It's when it's bad. There are going to be days when we are going to jump through adversity. I need you with me. Don't jump on me when it's good and then off me on the bandwagon when it's bad. I need you when it's bad because we have to do this together. Why do I bring this up? First of all, to say there is some truth in what he said at the NC State game, but also to say how he wraps up the statement saying, we talked about I gave a specific time. I said 3 or 4 years, and I'm good with it. That's what I believed at the time, and that's what I believe it takes to fix this program. I went through and read the entire transcript. You can find it on Card Chronicle, Mike Rutherford's website. It's posted on there. He does not say at any point in time it's going to take 3 or 4 years to fix the program. That's lying. It is. He may have said that at some other time when he, you know, introduced Nolan Smith or Danny Manning or whatever, but in the introductory press conference that he's referenced to, he never says it's going to take 3 or 4 years. And that's why I bring the first quote in there, because I don't want it to just sound like I'm trying to crap on him, but it's not a full truth that you were always saying it was going to be 3 or 4 years. So one, that's lying in the press conference, which is never a good thing. But two, you're blaming the fans. You're trying to pin all this on the fan base. The fan base isn't the one going out there losing games. The fan base isn't the one that's saying Tyler Johnson doesn't have the right tights and that's why he's not playing. The fan base isn't the one that's saying Mike Woodson tricked you after you blew an 8-point lead in the last 3.5 minutes. The fan base isn't the one that says Caron Davis is going to the transfer portal and then Caron Davis sitting in the stands is saying, nah, that's a lie. And then you're saying, never mind, you're kicked off the team, then trying to play it off like you didn't release the first statement. The fan base isn't doing any of that. Most importantly, the fan base isn't the one getting their asses kicked every time they hit the floor. The fan base isn't on an 8-game losing streak to end the season after you said, this season is turning around, we're starting to hit our stride, which there's a quote of him saying that on February 12th. The rest of the year, Louisville lost 8 games in a row. I believe we're only in single digits once or twice. Ugly. Ugly. Just incredibly ugly. So I don't want to hear about how the fan base is the reason why this is so bad. That, oh, the players don't have any confidence. It's broken. It's fractured. We heal it. No. Louisville as a fan base is a very passionate fan base. Just like, again, to bring it back to the Woodson stuff also. Indiana is a very passionate fan base. And Louisville fans want to win. And there's nothing wrong with wanting to win and realizing, look, we get it. It wasn't a very good situation that you took over. And he was in a point to where, you know, Kenny Payne saying we forgot about preaching patience. You know what makes you forget about preaching patience? When you start out going 4-28 in year one, patience goes out the door. You lose that benefit of doubt when you go 4-28. So, yes, I agree that when Kenny Payne was hired, a vast majority of Louisville fans, not that they were going to sit through 12-52, they were never going to do that, but Louisville fans realized this was going to take a few years to get where they wanted to if things worked well. But when you go out and you lose to Lenoir Ryan, and you start the season 0-9, including losses to Wright State, Bellarmine, and Appalachian State, you lose so much of that goodwill early on so quickly when, on top of it, you're not getting the recruits that you were promised. The whole reason we were supposed to be okay with Kenny Payne not being a head coach is because he was supposed to recruit, and he hadn't been able to recruit. I mean, that just hasn't been the level of player that we were sold he was going to get, that he was going to go out and get John Calipari Kentucky-like recruiting classes. That just hasn't happened here at Louisville. Not to say he hasn't brought anyone good. I mean, Huntley Hatfield's been really good. Tyler Johnson was a really nice surprise this year. Sky Clark showed flashes like he did against NC State on Tuesday. But at the end of the day, it's not what you were expecting in terms of the caliber of player. Not to say there's not talent on the team. There is talent on the team. If there was a competent coach coaching the team, I think they could have won a lot more games this year. Last year's a little bit of a different story, even though that team had some like 8 top 80 recruits. It was just incredibly poorly constructed, only having L. Ellis as a guard on the roster. And that, again, goes back on to Kenny Payne. But when you go 4-28, you lose any and all luxury of pressure or of patience. At that point, it's okay. This was an utter disaster. It was a year last season where there were no expectations. It was roll the ball out there, try hard, win 12, 13, 14, 15 games, show you're laying a foundation, and hit the recruiting trail. That's what year one was supposed to be. Not year zero, like KP tried to claim, but year one. Even if they would have gone 8-24 in year one and had a year exactly like they had a year two, not year one, year two. This was not year one, KP. This is year two. But if they went 8-24 in year one, it wouldn't have been good, but it would have been better than 4-28. And there would still be a good amount of people that could pin everything, you know, what happened with Mac and Gaudio, the FBI cloud, all that stuff, to where I think you would have had a chance this year to build on that. And maybe, you know, if you got to 15, 16, 17 wins or whatever, you'd probably be getting a third year. But because you start out at 4-28, that sets everything aflame to where you had to be on the bubble and on the fringe of being an NCAA tournament team in year two. And that was maybe unfair, but when you go 4-28, you don't get the luxury of that type of stuff. So, sorry for the rant there. I know a lot of that's probably been heard and said before, but at the end of the day, when Kenny Payne says that about the fan base and tries to blame the fan base for why they lost so much, that's just not right. And I feel like it's worth calling him out for it. So, yes, they are moving on from Kenny Payne. That's, you know, Jeff Goodman, Field 68, had the first report on. Pete Thamel's confirmed that. It sounds like it's going to happen sometime during the day on Wednesday. But why are they moving on? I mean, obviously, like I've said 18,000 times, 12-52, all the stuff off the court. I went through some of that earlier as well. So there's that angle of things.
As you guys know by now, we've partnered with BetMGM this season. We'll be using BetMGM lines to make all of our picks, and we'll have special offers for the listeners and the viewers of the Field of 68 as we all get ready for the best month of the year, March Madness. If you haven't signed up for BetMGM yet, you can use the bonus code FIELD150 and you will get $150 in free bets on your first wager with BetMGM, regardless of whether or not you win that first bet. Here's the best part. All you need to do is deposit and bet $5 of your hard-earned money. This is how you make it work. Download the BetMGM app and sign up using the bonus code FIELD150. That's FIELD150. Deposit at least $5 and place your first wager on any game. you will receive up to $150 in bonus bets regardless of the outcome of your bet. Just make sure you use that bonus code FIELD150 when you sign up. And remember, BetMGM is now available in one wallet in select states. As a New Jersey resident, this is super convenient when I have to go cover games in Philly or New York, which happens quite a bit. When you cross state borders, you just log into your existing account and fire away. You don't have to create a new account in each state. It's easy, it's simple, and it's clean. And most importantly, we have some fun stuff coming up for the conference tournaments and for the NCAA tournament. Bet insurance tokens, college hoops odds boost, and my personal favorite, a nice little parlay boost here and there. So download the BetMGM app and sign up today. Big news, guys. I am thrilled to announce that we have partnered with Autograph, a company founded by the GOAT himself, Tom Brady. The Autograph fandom app gives you access to the best college hoops content, fan contests, and exclusive rewards like discounted tickets, all for doing the things that diehard fans like you already do, following your favorite team in the news and listening to podcasts just like this one. When Tom, and yes, I am calling him Tom, we're on a first name basis these days, co-founded Autograph, he had one mission in mind: change the fan experience for the better. It works like this. You get all of your college hoops content you want in one place. You get articles from your favorite writers, pods from your favorite hosts, contests from your favorite creators, all on the feeds and the sites that you already enjoy. But instead of having to go to all these different places, it all comes to you in one spot, the Autograph fandom app. But here's the best part. The more content that you consume, the higher you rank in the app. As you consider the level up in status on the app, you can unlock unique rewards curated exclusively for you. So download the free Autograph app in the App Store and use the referral code F68, that's F68, or tap in at the link in the description below or in the podcast app of your choosing to start earning points for doing something as normal as listening to this very podcast.
There's, of course, the angle now, which is that we're going to spend a lot more time on of what's Louisville going to do next. And there's been a lot of different reporting on there of who there's going out there. I mean, Drew Diener's been reporting. Eric Crawford's been firing off tweets. Goodman had the thing in Field of 68 Daily last week as well. So we're just going to kind of run through some candidates here. And I'll give you some of my thoughts on them. Again, this Floyd Treats Finest, part of the Field 68 Podcast Network. Like, subscribe, all that stuff here on YouTube, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, like, review, do all that type of stuff. We're on Twitter, obviously. Also, I'm trying to do a better job of saying that. I need to be better about that. But Scott Drew, it's the name that is catching like wildfire right now. And that's going to be who Louisville is taking their run at, who they're going to try to swing for the fences for. First of all, and I said this last week, but it's worth repeating. Credit to Josh Hurd for swinging for the fences and trying to get Scott Drew. That is, you know, a ballsy move. It is a move that is not the most highly or the most likely to work. But if you're able to pull it off, that's obviously spectacular. But for Josh Hurd to say, look, we're going for the best candidates. We think he is the best candidate. He's the dude that built Baylor out of nothing for the last 20 years. And we think we can get him to lead this program. You got to try to get him. And you offer him all the money in the world that you can. I don't know what that number is, but you throw every lifeline. You say contract, NIL, give him a horse farm. And no matter what you do, you make him say no to that job. And that's smart. That's what you need to do if you're Josh Hurd in this situation. Now, Pat Forty had an article for Yahoo earlier on Tuesday that brings up a couple of good points I want to bring up and dissect a little bit. First of all, Forty says, look, Baylor doesn't care all that much about basketball. If Louisville were to offer him $10 million, Baylor probably isn't paying $10 million for a basketball coach. that leads to the question of, can Louisville offer Scott Drew $10 million? $10 million a year, that would be. My guess would be no. I mean, I know there's been a lot of push that Louisville has the money from donors to go out and pay as much as they need. But I just, again, that's going to be $47.9 million of the buyout if KP takes the full $8 million, which at this point we don't know. At, you know, about 1:45 in the morning here on Wednesday morning at this point, but maybe by the time this publishes on later in the morning on Wednesday, we'll have that idea. But if it is the full buyout, then that's about $48 million in buyouts you're paying in an 8-year span from 2018 to 2026. And you're saying, okay, that's a lot of money. If you get the donors to pay up, maybe you get a big chunk of that. But if you can offer Scott, but I don't know if you can cobble up enough to offer Scott Drew $10 million a year plus all the NIL things that you would need to pry him away from Baylor. If that number is $6 or $6.5 million, and that's as high Louisville goes, Forty says that Drew would likely stay at Baylor where he's more comfortable. He's built everything. They've built the new arena and practice facilities for him and basically let him design everything with that. So I personally agree with 40 on that, that if Louisville can't cobble up something like $9 or $10 million a year, it's going to be tough to get Scott Drew. But if you're Josh Hurt, again, damn it, you got to try, because that would probably be the best hire you could make. In addition, 40 brought up a really good point. It's incredibly rare for a coach who has won a national title in college to leave directly for another college job. And before anyone says anything, yes, Rick Pitino won a title at Kentucky and then ended up coaching at Louisville. You know what he did between those two things that Kentucky fans love to forget? When they went, when especially during the Pitino era, with him, you know, heel turning to UofL from UK, the fact that he coached and was the president of the Boston Celtics for a number of years, he did not go straight from Kentucky to Louisville. He went to the Celtics, flamed out, got fired, then ended up at Louisville. You think about, you know, people say, you know, Billy Donovan. That wouldn't be going from college to college. It'd be going from college to NBA back to college. But we kind of got our thoughts last week on Donovan with Coach Lederman, to where I still don't really think that's too likely. But over the last 60 years, Pat 40 of Yahoo points this out. There's only been two college coaches to have won a national championship and then left for another college job. In the last 60 years, it hasn't happened since 1992. That was Raleigh Massimino, going from Villanova, where he won the title in 1985, to UNLV in 92. The other one was Norman Sloan, winning the title with David Thompson in 1974, ending the long UCLA streak, and then leaving to go to Florida in 1980. Those are the only two times that's happened. So it would be very unprecedented for something like that to happen, which is what it would take for Scott Drew to come to Louisville. And I think that's a good historical perspective. I don't know how much it means, but it just showed you how rare it is for a coach to do that. And I do feel like it's worth pointing out. If not Scott Drew, who is it going to be? There is a big smorgasbord of names that have been thrown out there. And first of all, I like the fact that, yes, even though Hurd's going after Scott Drew very clearly, it's not the type of situation it was with Kenny Payne or Chris Mack or even Rick Pitino with Tom Jurich, of singling out saying, this is the one dude we're looking at. It's all the chips in. We're predestined to get this guy. Josh Hurd's doing an actual search. And I've said this before, I'm going to say it again. I think that's a very good thing for Louisville, that Josh Hurd is doing an actual search. Because we've done this, the predestined marriage, twice, well, three times. Pitino, it worked out fabulously. Yes, I know there's all the stuff at the end, but you won a national title, went to three Final Fours. And you made the second weekend eight times. It's hard to argue with that. But Chris Mack ended up not working, and Kenny Payne obviously did not work. To where I like that Josh Hurd now can sit and vet candidates and go through and say, look, We tried the number one hot name up and comer in Chris Mack that just won Coach of the Year, was a one seed, didn't work. Again, predestined marriage. We tried the predestined marriage, or I guess arranged marriage is probably a better term to use. We tried the arranged marriage with Kenny Payne, the alum from UofL who played here, won a title under the legendary coach of Denny Crum, but was never a head coach before. We decided to look past that, and that obviously flamed out spectacularly. Now he can say, the ball is in my court. I am no longer the interim AD. Of course, Vince Tyree hired Mac, not Josh Hurd, which is worth bringing up. But the ball's in my court now, being Josh Hurd. I can go through and decide who is the best man for the job, if you're Louisville. And you can go in and say, I'm going to hire that man. And say, this is who I'm handing the keys to the program over. This is my choice. This isn't pressure from the fans, pressure from former players, pressure from donors, from anyone. This is Josh Hurd's coaching hire. And yes, that's pining a lot on what happens moving forward with Josh Hurd and how he's viewed as an athletic director. And it's probably the most important hire he's going to make as the AD of UofL. But I think it's a really great opportunity for him to go out and block out all the noise and hire who he thinks is going to be the best man. If you look at a lot of the names, other than, you know, Eric Crawford threw out Chris Holtman's name, which, no offense to Chris Holtman, but you managed to go from being a two seed in the NCAA tournament in 2021 to fired by 2024, midway through the year. I don't need that guy around the Louisville program at this point. I just don't. I mean, I'm sure he's a great basketball mind. I guarantee you he knows way more about the sport than I'll ever know. But when you had as much talent as he had at Ohio State and still struggle and collapse 2 years in a row, I don't need that. That's not, to me, that's the one name that I've seen that said you cannot do that if you're Josh Hurd in Louisville. There's so many other ways you could sell so many other coaches that have been thrown out there and Louisville's probably considering. Chris Holtman's the one I'm like, you just can't do that at this stage. Maybe two, three years ago, if you could have said Chris Holtman, after, you know, two seed Ohio State winning a bunch at Darius Washington, E.J. Liddell, those guys, really, really good team. Yes, I would have said that'd probably be a good name that you could have, but now you can't do that. But I look at names like Dusty May, and I say, you mean the guy that was in the Final Four last year? Hell yeah, let's sign up for that. I mean, I think he would be a phenomenal fit. Other than Scott Drew, I think he'd be the best hire Louisville could have, because he's young, he's up and coming. He's, you know, I know 40 talked about this in the Yahoo article as well, and I talked about it on ESPN Louisville Plus live stream a couple nights ago. My guy Phil Baker, who we've had on the pod before, brought this up as well, of trying to find the next, I think I said this on the roundtable Strebel, as James Strebel as well, on Tuesday, but you look at the current landscape of college basketball. Coach K's gone. Roy Williams is gone. Jay Wright's gone. Jim Boeheim's gone. Rick Pitino and John Calipari are still there, and Pitino will probably coach until the day he dies. But you know, guys, joking aside, but you don't know how much longer those guys are going to be there. Jay Wright's gone. We're in a transition phase in college coaching. Tom Izzo probably won't be coaching too much longer. John Beilein, though he never won a title, is someone that's not there anymore. We'll see how long Mark Few has. But we're transitioning from that era of coaches to a new era. And who are going to be the stars of that next era? The other thing 40 brings up, if Tom Jurys didn't get Rick Pitino, his backup option was a young gun from Hofstra named Jay Wright. That would have worked brilliantly as well. So what I'm looking at is, who is the next Jay Wright? And can Josh Hurd, if you don't get Scott Drew, identify who that next Jay Wright is? And that's where you get names like Dusty May, who I think is more like Shaka Smart than Jay Wright, because obviously he went to the Final Four. But that's where you get Josh Hurd's name. That's where you get Pat Kelsey's name. That's where, even though they're power conference guys at this point, Jerome Tang, Lamont Paris, Who are the next dudes? I think Oates and Musselman are a little bit beyond that at this point because they've kind of established themselves a bit more. But I look at these names and I say, okay, who is going to be the dude that can be one of the next faces of college basketball? Like I'm already sold. Like, Nate Oates is already becoming that, and I think he's going to be that, whether it's at Alabama or somewhere else for the next number of years. You're just leading the revolution on the college side of modern basketball, pace and space, the 3-point line, layups, not shooting mid-range, all that stuff. I think he's a star in the making. He's a rising star in this. But who can be along the next names? Because if you can get one of those dudes, yes, it would be great, you know, if you were to get a Mick Cronin. But Mick Cronin's a little bit older. I mean, I don't have his age off the top of my head. I can look it up real quick. In fact, I'll go ahead and do that right now. But I know Scott Drew's 53. Mick Cronin's 52, so basically the same age. These are dudes that probably aren't coaching for the next 30 years. you'll probably be able to get, like, you know, 10, 15 years of that, but they're already in their coaching prime. Could you get someone that's just starting to enter their prime as opposed to Scott Drew and Cronin, who are already in their prime? You get more good years that way. And that's where, again, I look at May and Josh Schertz. I understand that Josh Schertz probably has to make the NCAA tournament for him to be seriously considered for the Louisville job. And I sure as hell hope, not just for the Louisville aspect of it, just watching Indiana State this year, is they've been incredibly fun to watch. And they're a top 30 KenPom team, top 30 in the net. I get it. They only have one quad one win, but that's absolutely a team that if you watch them play, that's an NCAA tournament team. And I really hope he gets that chance to go and make a run in March, but even if he doesn't, Indiana State hadn't been ranked since some dude named Larry Bird was on campus in the late 1970s. To take a dead-end job after having so much success in Division II, 40 and Phil both called him, you know, the basketball Kalen DeBoer, a dude that just wins no matter where he's at, then he goes to Indiana State, which is very much a dead-end job. That is not a job of a lot of sense. As I said, they had not been ranked since Larry Bird was on campus. I couldn't tell you when the last time they made the NCAA tournament. We can find that out real quick. The last time they made an NCAA tournament, Indiana State. It's been a very, very, very long time. I mean, obviously they made it under Larry Bird, with Larry Bird and all that, but they made the first round in 2011. Before that, 2001, 2019, 79. If you were to get them to the NCAA tournament, that'd be a fifth appearance all time for a program that was pretty much dead in the water when Josh Schertz took over. And he has them within 3 years on the brink of an NCAA tournament bid from the Missouri Valley Conference. The fact that you're even talking about a Missouri Valley Conference team getting an at-large, I know it happens from time to time, but it's not the most likely occurrence. Plus, again, very fun, modern style that I think would translate really well to Louisville, and a dude that understands how you can turn something around quickly. And that's the biggest thing with all these other guys. And I'll get back to Dusty May in a minute. But Schertz has turned Indiana State around in 2-3 years. I think something like 51-17 the last 2 years. Jerome Tang turned Kansas State around in 1 year. Lamont Paris has South Carolina going to be in the NCAA tournament, a double bye in a really, really good SEC tournament this week. 2 years. Oates got Alabama turned around really quickly. Musselman got Arkansas turned around quickly. These are dudes that understand the sense of urgency of, look, I get it. I wasn't the one losing all these games to the previous administration, but the fan base has had to sit through the piling ashes of garbage for however long it's been, and they're desperate to win. They don't have the patience for a long rebuild now that maybe they did even at the start of Kenny Payne's tenure. You gotta win. You gotta win quickly, and these are dudes that understand that. To where if you were to get any of those guys that I mentioned, I think Louisville would be in a really, really good spot as a basketball program. to where, you know, I'll go down the list again. Dusty May. There is one angle with Dusty May that more so than the other dudes here, and that's the Ohio State angle. There is no doubt in my mind that Louisville's a better job than Ohio State. And that traditionally, historically, all that stuff. But if you were to get into a bidding war with Ohio State, that's a tough one to win. It just is. I mean, Ohio State has that pocketbooks, and they have the ability to pay, if they want to, as much as literally anyone in college sports. And that will be tough if Dusty May ends up being linked with both Louisville and Ohio State. That becomes a bidding war. Another thing, you know, everyone, a lot of people got mad at the Goodman stuff on Field of 68 and all that stuff on the Field of 68 Daily last week. The thing under all the Louisville coaching candidates he had was about Dusty May in Indiana, saying Dusty may not be all that interested in Indiana because of the pressure that comes with the IU job. One, an angle that I literally just thought of, would he want the pressure of the Louisville job? Because those are pretty similar. That's an interesting question to ask. And two, we don't know if that's true or not. I mean, Goodman knows Dusty May. I'm sure he's getting that from reliable sources, but you never know. You know, money talks, and you know, being he's an IU grad, all that stuff. It all talks. So we'd see what would happen if, you know, Louisville made a run at him, or if eventually if Indiana's job's open, they made a run at him. But the other thing that Louisville fans say about May that I just don't understand is saying, well, he's just a step holder until the Indiana job opens. Which, first of all, maybe he doesn't want the IU job. But second of all, I don't know if there's an angle about this coaching search or any coaching search that I care less about than that. And let me tell you why. Number one, if IU wanted Dusty May, and if Dusty May were to take the Louisville job and the IU job were to open next year, the year after, or whenever, if Indiana's looking at Dusty May at that point, it's because he's winning at Louisville. Like, if he were to leave, he would be leaving Louisville in such a much better position than what it is right now, to where if a school like Indiana, which is very much on a level opportunity aspect as Louisville is in terms of how prestigious, how good the job is, that means he's winning at Louisville. And that puts you in a way better position to hire the next coach than what you're at right now. So for me, even if he were to leave, first of all, maybe he'd stay. Now, everyone thought Denny Crum was going to go back to UCLA when John Wooden left, and about the 18 other times the head coaching job opened, he never left. Rick Pitino was a dude that, you know, never stayed anywhere longer than, what, 6-7 years, and he stayed in Louisville for 17. When you win there, things are usually pretty damn good for you in life. Like, so there's also that possibility, but even if he were to leave for the Indiana job or an NBA job or whatever, that means you're winning a lot of games, you're probably having NCAA tournament success, and you're back to either where you want to be as a program or very close to it. So for me, I don't really give a crap about the Indiana ties when it comes to Dusty May in terms of the Louisville job. You hire him because he's a great coach to hire. And if he leaves, that means he did his job and you're in a much better spot as a university and as a basketball program. On Jerome Tang, I covered shirts a little bit, so I'll just go straight to Jerome Tang. It seems like Scott Drew's number one, and then May and Church have kind of separated themselves a little bit, and then it seems like there's everyone else. That's just me kind of reading it from the outside. I don't really have insider info on that. That's just, you know, looking at what Crawford's reported, what Diener's reported, you know, and what everyone else has been saying. That seems like a little bit the dynamic that's happening. But Jerome Tang's a name. I don't get why some people are down on Jerome Tang when out of one side of their mouth, they talk up Scott Drew, then the other side of their mouth, they're saying you can't hire Jerome Tang. If you don't hire Scott Drew, or if you can't hire Scott Drew, there is not a coach that's more like Scott Drew in college basketball than Jerome Tang. And that's literally because he spent the previous 15 or so years before he took the Kansas State job on Scott Drew's staff as his lead assistant, and was the lead assistant when they won the title in 2021. So if you want someone who knows Scott Drew and how Scott Drew works, Jerome Tang's that dude if you can't actually have Scott Drew. But more importantly than that, it's what he's done at Kansas State. He took over a team that did not have any expectation. They were picked dead last in the Big 12 in year one. You bring in Keontae Johnson from Florida, who was pretty much forgotten about because of the heart issues. You bring in a lot of unheralded transfers. You convince a guy, Marquise Noel, to hold over for a year, for another year. You know, Louisville definitely doesn't have a New York guard that just needs a little bit of polishing and has shown flashes of potential this year. They definitely don't have that. Wink, wink, Tyler Johnson. But he's able to convince Marquise Noel to stay, and they turn into gangbusters last year. They were a 3 seed. They went to the Elite Eight. Marquise Noel was one of the 2-3 biggest stories of that tournament. I'm not saying Tyler would just suddenly become Marquise Noel, but there are comparisons there to that situation. But he was able to turn around quickly. And I get it, this year hasn't gone as well as he had hoped. But you have to factor in the fact that Naquan Tomlin got booted off the team and Tang wasn't very happy with administration on that. There were some very big differences of thought processes there. Where Tomlin ends up at Memphis, they've had some key injury issues. And even despite that, they have 4 top 25 wins. And they beat Kansas on their home court in back-to-back years for the first time in about 15 years. That doesn't happen very often at Kansas State. He understands the sense of urgency to win. He understands, we've seen it with the Kansas rivalry, that he can play the rivalry aspect of it, get his team up to play well in rivalry games. I get it, they did just get blown out in Fog Allen Fieldhouse last week, but in the other 3 games they've played, they've won 2 of them, competed their asses off in the third one at Fog Allen. And Kansas State going 2-2 in a 2-year span against Kansas, that's pretty damn good for them. That's something that happens often, rivalry or not with the University of Kansas under Bill Self. But he's a guy that, even despite that, the 4 top 25 wins, probably on the wrong side of the bubble. And even with all that adversity, playing in the pressure cooker that is the Big 12, that's absolutely the best conference in the country, he's still been able to go out there and win games this year. I think he would be a phenomenal hire. Now, Lamont Paris, I think, would be great as well. Talk about a guy who year one at South Carolina didn't really do a whole lot of winning, but still, even then, you talk about sense of urgency. He brought in G.G. Jackson. Number one recruit, reclassified, still a top 5 recruit. You went at Kentucky in Rupp Arena year one. You showed flashes of laying a foundation of, okay, here's who we could become. And guess what happens the next year? You go from being picked 14th in the SEC to getting a double bye, surefire into the NCAA tournament. I think he would be phenomenal as well. And then there's the other guys we've talked about at length, Cronin, Oates, and Musk. We don't really get into all that, but it'll be fascinating to see how this all plays out. Obviously, I went a bit longer than I thought I would. Yeah, you guys know me. I like to talk. But Louisville, moving on from Kenny Payne, might be official by the time this publishes in the morning. If not, it'll probably be official sometime Wednesday. If not, Thursday. And obviously, we are in full coaching search mode here from here on out. We'll do some, It's March Madness. I'm going to talk some NCAA tournament too as well. So we'll probably do more of a full episode probably Friday. Just full disclosure, another reason why I'm doing this, 1:50 or whatever time it is at this point. I got my dad in town tomorrow in Atlanta, so I'll be, busy. I work a lot over the next couple days. So probably Friday is what I'm going to try to get a full-fledged project either with Coach Lieberman or someone else, just to be completely honest and upfront there. I work and I got my dad in town the next couple days. So it's going to be, so I'm going to be a pretty busy guy the next few days. So if something major happens, I'll try to get something out. But I want to make sure just to get an instant reaction of Kenny Payne's out and everything, so we could go ahead and make sure that I could get my thoughts out there for you guys. Because, that's why I do the podcast, for big moments like this, to be able to react to it. So until next time, probably later this week, we'll be back here on Floyd Street's Finest. Thanks for tuning in. And again,